Yeah, well, you know, there's always a lot said on talk radio about these issues. The simple fact is, under the Constitution and the standing orders of this Commonwealth and this Republic, that once you miss three sittings of the Parliament, your seat shall be vacated. That is a mandatory operation of law consequence, and there is nothing that the Speaker or the members of Parliament or anybody at this time can do to stop the process of the law and the operation of law taking effect. What the Speaker of the House did at the press conference was to give the legal position and the effect of the members of Parliament refusing through their political boycott to attend the House for three sittings. And she was declaring to the world at the press conference what was the legal, perhaps even the political consequence of that boycott after three sittings. Now the House sits again on the 25th, and I have no doubt that at that time the Speaker or somebody will take the matter up and make the appropriate statement and declaration in the House to put on the parliamentary record the fact that by operation of law these two members of Parliament have had their seats vacated for refusing to attend. Now there's been a lot of talk too about the court, but the court only applies once a decision has been made either by the Speaker of the House or by the House of Assembly or by any member of Parliament who believes, regardless of what the position in fact is, that there was in fact no three sittings of the House, and in fact he did not miss three consecutive sittings of the House, and as a result the vacation or the decision that he should vacate his seat or the ruling or the statement or the declaration, put it at whatever level you want, was wrong because he did not miss the three sittings, then he redressed from the court under Section 40 of the Constitution. The funny thing about all of this, though, if I can say this and conclude by saying so, is that these men want to eat their cake and have it. They want a boycott of the House and maintain that they're still members of the House, and then turn wrong and accuse the Speaker of the House of being anti-democratic and unjust merely because she states to the world what the legal operation of the constitutional provisions are.
Do you see a by-election coming through very soon?
Well, it's a matter for if people put their names forward. If Edison James and the gentleman from Salisbury feel the government is so corrupt, then they should not get themselves nominated for by-election. They should just leave the seats vacant and or let somebody else who wants to participate in the election and do the people's business get nominated and do the people's business. Perhaps the best political trick Edison James and Sprague's John can do is not to get nominated at all. That would be wonderful news for democracy, I think.
And as one of government's advisors, do you think a by-election is the best thing for the country at this time?
Well, you know, that's a great question, and that's a question you should have addressed to Ron Green and to the members of the United Workers' Party. Instead of spending so much time, political resources, financial resources, on this political theatrics and what I call the theater of nonsensities, that's a question you should ask them, whether it's worth their while and the country's while to participate in the by-election. I have my own view as what should happen at that by-election, but I'm really not prepared to discuss it at this time. But that's a matter for them. You see, when you keep playing games with the people and you keep playing games with the parliament and you keep playing games with the law, you pay the price. The UWP keep complaining about the rule of law. They have lost every single case they have taken to the court so far, from the 2005 petitions to every single challenge they have made of the speaker's decisions. They've lost every single solitary one. So the question remains now, who do you judge? Do you judge the court and the speaker, or do you judge the acts of the United Workers Party that are yet to find favor with the independent and impartial courts? I mean, every single challenge to the speaker's decisions have failed. Now, what that is, what story does that tell us? It tells us that the United Workers Party are caught up in their own game of brinksmanship and political stupidity, and that was reflected in the 2009 general election. The United Workers Party, you know, people must not forget that. went from 15,000 plus votes in 2005 to just over 12,000 in 2009. And they need to look at the mirror and ask themselves a very pointed question. Where did these 4,000 votes go?
Understood that Domlek is filing court action against the government.
Well, I cannot really say much at this stage. Domlek attempted to institute arbitration proceedings. The government filed an application to stop it. We have had an agreement to, by consent, that there will be no arbitration pending the determination of the substantive claim filed by the Attorney General, which I think comes up sometime in October or thereabouts, as to whether or not the act which repealed the 1996 Electricity Supply Act contravened any rights which the Domlek may have had under the repealed act. And I think it's a very interesting case concerning the powers of Parliament and government to act in the public interest. Bearing in mind, you know, that Domlek has sued for seeking $100 million United States dollars damages. The government has to defend it. And instead of people taking the patriotic position and seeking to understand the government's position, as the government took the very strong position in the Shangri-La matter, you have political acolytes on the radio complaining about fees that Alec Lawrence and myself has received, which is peanuts compared to what the case is all about, the amounts of the case. And I am absolutely positive peanuts to what I suspect Domlek may well have to pay their lawyers for the arbitration and for the proceedings before the High Court. These are matters of national issue, my friend. These are matters protecting the sovereign integrity of the state. And then you find political acolytes, because of the naked political bias to the United Workers Party, want to ridicule the position of the government by seeking to talk about monies that Alec Lawrence and I make on that, which is, to me, the height of stupidity, really. I mean, I can't find any other words to describe it except naked political stupidity.
Are you confident that the court will rule in the government's favor?
My friend, one of the things that I've learned over my 20-odd years of practice is that being confident is a good sign. Being prepared is another good sign. But these things are in the hands of the court. And one of the things I am extremely grateful for those who negotiated and agreed to our constitutional provisions, is that we have a right, well, all parties have a right of appeal to the Court of Appeal, and from the Court of Appeal, except in election petition matters, to the Judicial Committee of the Privy Council in the United Kingdom. So even if we were to win or lose in the High Court on any matter, that would not be the end of the issue. There is no question that parties who may lose in the High Court will want to test the judgment delivered in the Court of Appeal. And that's one of the reasons that all of my years of experience tell me or taught me, is that you don't celebrate when you win a High Court decision. So my answer to you is we are confident and we are very anxious to have this matter taken through the judicial process, because we think this case is a case which is in the public interest and which needs to be fought tooth and nail regardless of the cost.